Welcome to Performance Anxiety. I'm your host, Mark Shea. This week, we feature Leah Shapiro and Peter Hayes from Black Rubber Motorcycle Club. We talk about how Leah met up with the band. We talk about what she and Peter did before BRMC, including maybe a little marching band info. We talk about Leah's brain surgery for Chiari malformations and her subsequent recovery. And we're reassured by Peter that they have nothing against Christmas. I hope you enjoy this week's episode. It's Black Rubber Motorcycle Club on Performance Anxiety.
Hi, I'm Leah Shapiro from BRMC, and you should come hang out and listen to me talk on performance anxiety. Does that work?
And I'm Peter Hayes.
Sorry.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for coming on tonight and agreeing to all this. Black Rebel Motorcycle Club is, it's one of the bands I've been listening to since their very first album, and they're so influential to just to my life in general. They're just amazing, and it's I kind of threw out a feeler to you, not really even expecting you to reply to it at all. So this is a huge thrill for me. So thank you for coming on.
Well, thank you for having me.
Oh, believe me, it's absolutely my pleasure. You were actually born in Denmark, is that right?
Uh-huh. Yes.
All right. So, how long were you there? I mean, did you just grow up there? Did you spend your whole life there? When did you come over to America? And how did?
Well, so my family is my dad is from the States originally.
Okay.
And so he came over to Europe, I think, after he had finished college.
Okay.
He just wanted to get the hell out of the States. He was tired of it. Ran off to Europe and sort of bummed around a couple of different places. But he ended up, there was this sort of artist hippie camp up in the northern part of Denmark where, like, a lot of artists hung out there. I think Allen Ginsberg was up there. And John Lennon, like, all kinds of different people and just random hippies and stuff. And my dad ended up there somehow.
John Lennon and your dad.
That's I don't crazy. Know if they were there at the exact same time, but
it doesn't matter. It's still a great story.
Yeah, there was a bunch of interesting people coming and going. And so he spent some time there, and then he met my mom, I think it was like on a plane going to Paris. And yeah, then they got together and they lived for a short amount of time. They lived in Boston, which is where he grew up, kind of outside of Boston. But was born in the Bronx, I believe, and he was like 9, I think, roughly, when he left there to go up to New England. And then they moved back to Europe, and they were pretty young when they got married and had my brother, who's like 9.5 years older than me.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, so my grandparents on his side, they, of course, were still in the U.S., and my brother actually lives in New York, and I used to live in New York. So the family was always kind of spread out all over the place. So we'd go to the States a lot, and they'd come here, or we'd, like, go travel to some nice, sunny place.
Wow, that's your parents met and they went to Paris. That's so romantic. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, they lived for quite a while, them and their other artist friends. And some of them are still in Paris, and, you know, they're still very close with them. And yeah, there was just sort of an artist community at the time and it was people from all over the place. And then eventually they moved back to Denmark.
Was there, being a hippie commune type of place, was there a lot of music going on there?
Well, so I wasn't born yet when they lived in Paris. They had my brother, I think he maybe, like, his first year. He was born in Denmark, but I think they may have gone back to Paris. I can't totally remember the timeline, but they were back in Denmark pretty like quickly anyway after he was born.
Did you grow up with a lot of music in the house?
Yeah, definitely. My dad has like the most, like a pretty big vinyl collection with all kinds of stuff. Like old blues stuff, a lot of Rolling Stones and a lot of Frank Zappa and just a bunch of different stuff. And he's like a photographer, and in Denmark he ran this like nonprofit gallery. So there'd always be a lot of people at our house because they'd bring, like they'd have exhibitions and bring in people from all over the world. And, you know, there wasn't like a big budget or anything. So people would often stay at our house.
Oh, wow.
There's just always a lot of people around. That's kind of what I remember from growing up. Just a lot of people and parties at our house. I'd hide out downstairs in my room.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I didn't want anything to do with it. I thought they were all crazy.
Oh, my gosh.
But, yeah, so that was sort of the environment. Like, it was pretty loose and, like, mellow and easygoing, to say the least.
So at what point did you start picking up music and playing instruments? And what instrument did you start with?
Drums was the first thing that I started with. But I started fairly late. Like, I started in my last year of, like, gymnasium, it's called in Denmark, but it's sort of the equivalent-ish of high school.
Okay.
So I started my last year there, and I've been doing, I grew up kind of riding horses and doing competitions, like show jumping.
Oh, wow.
So that was like a whole other life. And then I had to kind of figure out what I was going to do after high school. And I'd always kind of had a bit of a panic of God, like I can't really picture myself having to grow up and like be responsible and go to the same office every day. And like the whole thing just seemed like something I'd just never be able to do.
Yeah.
Mature enough to do. Somehow I ended up starting drums, got very obsessed with it very quickly. And after I graduated high school, I went to Nottingham in England for a year, with a couple of friends of mine. And we all did this like 1 year music program at a school there.
Okay, but you just picked up the drums at that point.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I've been playing for like 6 months or something.
Oh, jeez.
But the summer before, I went to New York for, I think, like 1.5, 2 months. Okay. I found this amazing teacher in New York who I'm still, every once in a while, I'll reach out to him. And he really, like, he gave me a very good foundation and starting point to learn. So that was, you know, it was lucky that my brother lived there and he let me stay there the whole summer.
Oh, wow.
You know,
that's good. That's good.
That's a nice brother.
Yeah.
And then I went there, and then from there I ended up in Boston, and then in New York, and then here. That's sort of the fast forward version of.
So, and at what point I'm going to tell you right now, you're a difficult drummer to research. There is not a ton of stuff out there on you. So and most of it is just repeating the same things over and over again. And I found that you played in a couple of bands. One was the Dead Combo.
Now,
in looking that up, I actually found when I heard that, I was like, holy crap, I love the Dead Combo. And then I found out that there are two Dead Combos.
Yes, there's a Portuguese Dead Combo, and I think it's sort of more jazzy.
Yes. I know those guys.
Yeah. Then there's the Dead Combo that I was in, which is sort of like a mixture of Suicide and Iggy and the Stooges.
Oh, yeah. That's definitely not the Dead Combo that I have in my collection.
Very, very different Dead Combo. But
How long were you in that? When
I met BRMC.
Okay, okay. And then
yeah.
You're also in the Raveonettes.
Yeah, I did a couple of tours with them when they had their record Lust, Lust, Lust out.
Yes.
I think I did, I don't know, probably three tours or something with them.
Okay.
Most of it in the States, some of it in Europe. And that was sort of around the same time when I actually that was yeah it was at the same time as I was in Dead Combo. I think the first show I played with Dead Combo was opening up for the Raveonettes.
Oh wow, that's a busy night.
We were with Dead Combo. I met BRMC because we were opening up for them on when they were on their Baby 81 tour. So that's kind of how we met. Was really through that band.
Okay, so I saw a clip on YouTube of the Raveonettes playing on David Letterman.
Yes.
Oh, and God. I saw a very young-looking Leah Shapiro standing up in a black dress, just smacking, looked like a snare and a cymbal on one other drum.
Snare and a floor tom. There you go. That was it. It was very easy, and then I was running like the backing tracks.
Oh, okay. That I'll tell you what, that was a really wild performance, though. That was really cool.
Performance. It was a very easy gig, you know, having just two drums and just, like. These old school like backing track things. It was lots of fun and not super difficult.
With the limited kit, it might make it a little more difficult to be more creative, but I'm not a drummer, so I don't know.
With backing tracks, I think the focus needs to be that you're very much locked in with that, because otherwise it can sound, you know, it starts sounding like clammy and like you're dropping a bag of potatoes down a flight of stairs. It's not for everyone. Like you have to be really disciplined and precise, especially the way that they've changed their setup since then.
Okay.
But the way that was set up, that's definitely not for everyone. I guess there's some element of, you know, I wouldn't say that it's difficult, but you know, it's not for everyone. So. Yeah. No, I didn't do any recording with them or anything.
Okay.
It was strictly just tour of, hired gun for a couple of tours.
Okay. So and then after that, BRMC let the original drummer go.
Yes.
Now, how did the process of you hooking up with them happen?
Very quickly.
Okay. Good.
Yeah, I got a call, and then I had all of a sudden a whole lot of music to learn. I'm pretty sure there wasn't much of a backup plan on their end, because they were out on the road when I got a phone call to please start learning stuff.
So they didn't even really audition you. They just said, hey, come learn this.
I guess it was an audition, but it was an audition where there weren't really other people. So I think really crossing their fingers that I'd done my homework and was ready to go out on the road, which I put in the work. So luckily it all worked out.
I need to get those kind of auditions. Hey, just send us your podcast and we'll send you money. Oh, yeah, sure. You got it, man. No problem. Black Rebel Motorcycle Club has this appearance of an incredibly intense, incredibly serious band. And I'm sure that's that's cultured and very much a purposeful image that they put out there. Are you guys like that outside of the band? I mean, how loose do you guys get when you're touring and when you're recording?
When we work, we're definitely super serious. We all have like a tendency to go a bit OCD, and we're all very critical of everything that we do. So that's that part of it is very much true. That okay. I guess that we're serious, but aside from that, we're not particularly serious, or you know, take ourselves particularly seriously or anything like that. It's, I don't know. I mean, it's a. I guess that's kind of been an image that was labeled onto you guys. Pete, you would know more yeah. about that. I'm turning you over.
I
don't.
Oh no!
She's like, I didn't sign up for this.
No. I'm sorry to. I'm. What am I doing? I'm crashing the party. I just happen to be around.
That's no problem at all, man.
Are you serious?
Serious? I don't know. That was. I always feel like that was a mistake. That's kind of a mistake we made. You know, I guess we came at it where we didn't want to be useless. You know, we wanted to have a purpose.
Okay.
And we saw music should have a purpose in life, in society, and so we got known for kind of walking off interviews every once in a while when somebody either didn't even know the name of the band or just made silly comments or just kind of walk away and that. That word goes real quickly in this industry. So well, that's how it happened, you know. All right, I'll try it.
There you are. And you guys, I've seen you guys a few times live and I always have a fantastic time. It doesn't seem there's like I haven't noticed a whole lot of humor in the music up until possibly this album. Wrong Creatures. And since Peter, you're there, I've got both of you there. Maybe you can answer a couple of questions for me before you walk off of my interview.
Yeah. No.
First of all, what the hell is with is Circus Bazooko? That is a crazy song. And when I heard it, I was like, this isn't like anything else I've really heard. There's like Calliope and I don't even know what a bazooko is. Explain a little bit about that song.
Fear and Loathing.
Well, yeah, it's a reference to Fear and Loathing Las Vegas, the okay. movie. Yeah, well, so it's a reference to that book and the movie. And
is it the bar? Is the
yeah,
bar
it's the bar that yeah. when they waltz in all fucked up on ether or whatever, and they stumble into Circus. Oh,
okay, okay. But
the music itself, like, it started out with just Rob was messing about with some loops and then with weird sounds that we wouldn't normally use. And then it kind of just developed from there. And we just kind of, like, the pretty much the way we approach anything that we write, like, the just let the music guide the way. That's usually the better thing to do for us rather than to sit down and like have try to force some sort of idea to happen. And so we just went for it and it was very much open to doing whatever weird stuff that we could think of. And we did.
Well, it's my wife and my daughter's favorite song on the album. They absolutely
oh, yeah?
Love it. Yeah, they love that song. It's their favorite. So and mine's either Echo or Ninth Configuration, just to throw that out there. I love both of those. But, what does DFF stand for?
The full title is Drink, Fight, Fuck for Those Who Can't.
Okay.
Yeah. It's It's DFF, drink, fight, fuck, and then in parentheses, for those who can't.
Okay. That's good. See, I've always seen artists get Black Sabbath, Ozzy, particularly with SATO and NIB, which I eventually figured out was Nativity in Black, but I still don't know what the hell SATO stands for. So I figure since I got you guys on, I better ask that while I had the chance, because that'll just haunt me for the rest of my life if I don't ask.
We couldn't. It was kind of the decision if we would get some sort of parental guidance thing if we wrote it out fully, you know. So we're trying to dodge that. So
you did like a Van Halen for unlawful carnal knowledge kind of thing.
Oh, is that what they did? I don't.
Yeah, for unlawful carnal knowledge, the FUCK.
Oh. I didn't know that.
My show's educational. And I'm going to throw this out there right now since I got it on my brain and I still have Peter here for a little while. I saw and I pulled it off of YouTube, so don't get mad at me, but you guys early on did a cover of Ring of Fire in El Paso, and I absolutely love that. I had to rip that off of YouTube and put that so I can listen to it whenever I want. Ever think about doing something like that, actually recording those officially?
Well, you did a recording of Cool Water.
Yeah,
I've got that too.
Yeah, that was with the girl Courtney J. We did that song together. That's a good thought. Maybe
it'd be fun to do.
I would love to hear you guys do more old country stuff in the Black Over Motorcycle Club style, I guess, like you did Ring of Fire and El Paso. That was just really cool.
I always wanted to be in the mind of Marty Robbins and the discussion of that song, and just be on the fly on the wall because. That song to me it just doesn't lend itself to the horns and the speed of it, you know.
Yeah.
The actual recording just doesn't make sense to me, and I never heard the recording. I only heard my uncle play it for me.
Oh wow!
He was a family friend that we called my uncle. He'd play Cool Water in El Paso, and he'd act it out, and you know, as I was a little kid.
Oh my gosh!
And so I had never heard the original recording, and so I grew up with this version of it that was just kind of sad, you know, gunfighter story.
Oh yeah.
And then hearing it, you know, I wonder what the conversation was, you know, because I think it was a single. At the time, right?
Yeah, they but did a. The original version is like 8 minutes long, and then you know, back in the mid to late 50s, I mean, that's unheard of. So they trimmed it down.
That whole the whole speed of it, I'm wondering if that ad, if they had discussions like, well, we got to get this faster that way we can move it along quicker, more radio friendly. Yeah, you know. But I don't know, or else it just came out that way, but.
That song's part of a trilogy that Marty Robbins wrote, and I would love to hear you guys do that trilogy.
Oh God, yeah, I didn't know that for the longest time. I met Jim Marshall.
Oh,
when we're doing the Spread Your Love video,
mm-hmm.
we wanted to use it. There was a scene of me on getting out of bed, and there's this big poster of Johnny Cash giving the finger, right? Like
right.
That's what you wake up to every day.
Yeah.
I think it's still in the video. Maybe they, I don't think they had to cut that out. But anyways, we tried to do the right thing and ask and find him and ask him if we could use that image.
Okay.
And so we went up, just me and Charles Mayling, the guy who did the video, went up to his apartment, knocked on the door, and it was an amazing experience. You know, he's like, yeah, come on in. You know, it's like no one ever asked. I'm in so many lawsuits. Oh, everybody's using this image.
Yeah.
And then he just had all these stories of meeting all the, he had pictures everywhere of all, you know, all his famous pictures, you know.
That's
and
crazy.
He showed me the slides. There was, I think there's 6 or 8. Of that image, you know, of him in the process of giving the finger.
Right.
And there's a smile on his face, you know, as as he's giving it, you know, he's just messing with him.
Yeah.
And then there's that one iconic one that's just, you know, he looks like an angry, you know, he's going to beat the shit out of you.
Yeah, he's got that scowl on his face.
Yeah, you know, but that it was cool seeing the whole build up to that one picture and then, you know, and then
wow.
A couple after.
That's amazing. You know, it's funny you mentioned that. I had a similar experience with a different photographer. I was a photographer for several years. I went to college for it and all. And
that guy Jim Marshall made me aware of the trilogy. That's why say that.
Okay,
right?
Yeah.
That ties in. Sorry.
Okay, no, I kind of cut you off on that, so I'm sorry about that. But I'd been out of photography for a number of years, and a friend of mine from high school was talking to me about it. She'd seen some of the images I'd put on some social media, either Facebook or Twitter or something. She's like, you know, my father-in-law used to shoot a lot of bands back in the 60s and the 70s. And I'm like, oh, okay. He's like, no, he's actually really good. He did it professionally. I said, oh, who is he? He's like, oh, his name's Jim Cummings. He shot Hendrix. Blue Magic, a bunch of Motown stuff. Are you serious? Yeah. She's like, yeah, if you know anything about Photoshop, they're trying to restore some of his photos. I'll send you a couple files. So I got a couple files of some original Hendrix pictures that I hadn't seen before ever. So
that's wild.
But
wow.
Yeah, and I had no idea. I knew this girl throughout school, and I never had, I guess she wasn't married at the time, so I guess that makes sense. So that blew that whole story up. Never mind. Anyway, so wow. That was kind of cool. And here's one of the cool things about a podcast. I can edit whatever the hell I want because I kind of totally lost track of where we were going here with some of this stuff.
We're
serious image.
But if we're going to do doing cover songs.
Yeah, because you guys don't do a whole lot of them, but the ones you do are really good. They're really unique sounding.
Yeah, it could be fun to do that. Yeah. I've always wanted to cover some of Lee Hazelwood songs.
Oh, wow.
I just thought that would be really fun. But
there's the Rambler. Been thinking about that one. I'm the kind of guy that likes to roam around. Never in one place.
Oh.
Do a version of that.
Oh, yeah.
Dion. The Wanderer, right?
Wanderer.
We did one. What was it? What was that song? It was a B-side.
Off of How?
Angel Baby.
That's a question I have for you guys. And it's not necessarily about Angel Baby, but that was an intense interpretation of that song. You guys,
I tried to play it live and destroyed it so badly, I never did it again.
Oh, man. Well, I think, if I remember correctly, was that one of the holiday downloads, or was that one of the songs you got if you pre-ordered?
I think it was a B-side to Spectre at the Feast or something like that.
Yeah. Now, yeah. You guys used to do holiday downloads every Christmas. And you haven't done that in a couple of years. Is there a reason why? Because Every Christmas morning, I wake up, I look for it. I'm like, oh, not this year.
Yeah. I think we did. I can't remember. We try to do it, but it kind of depends on if we have something that's ready to like go, that's mixed and mastered. And I forget what the last one that we did was. I think we did Scare the Square at one point, which is another it's an instrumental song, oh, sort of in the vein of DFF.
Really? I don't know about that one. I'm going to have to look that up.
Yeah, that was like that one was kind of made in a similar way. Like, we have a habit of doing like little drum circle things, just messing around with drums and rhythms and like playing at the same time.
Okay.
Especially when we get to the point in the recording where like I'm more or less done with all the songs that I have to record, and other people are eating dinner or whatever, mess around, and some of them we record and save them, and maybe later on they turn into something. Like another one that was done, I think the first one was what's it called, the one that ended up being on that Batman game soundtrack.
Shadow on the Run.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Oh,
that's a great track.
As an instrumental, that was like that one was recorded or at least the drums and the bass and the like the basics of it, that was recorded in the house where we were writing while we were writing for Beat the Devil's Tattoo. Oh. And we were just messing around, and then we had this like instrumental version sitting around for ages. And so like those kind of things are like, for me, it's fun to play around with drums like that.
Yeah.
And it's kind of good. Like, they come in handy because you can do all kinds of weird stuff with it. And I like instrumental music. I think it's really fun to mess around with. So yeah, that's sort of like a side hobby that.
Well, you guys should compile these things and put them out. Maybe like you did with the effects of 333 or For Murder. Just put it on the website so people can just purchase a compilation of your weird stuff.
Of weirdness, yeah. Yeah,
because we have nothing against Christmas, right? But it just hasn't happened for a little bit.
Well, yeah. I'm glad we cleared that up. Because I'll be honest with you, I'm a completist. When I find an album, or not an album, a band that I like, I get everything. I'm hunting everything down. And you guys are definitely on the top of my list. So I'm always looking for, you know, the CSI Los Angeles soundtrack, the studio's Sound City, that's what it was.
Yeah.
So that was.
We did. Yeah, first album in that place.
That's a lot of history.
Didn't do much recording there. It was mostly mixing.
How did you guys get involved with the soundtrack for Studio Sound?
I think that was just a girl that reached out and asked, obviously that was like before me, he asked if he could interview the guys or one of the guys, and Rob ended up going out to do that interview, and he was a little nervous, so I went with him that night just for moral support.
Okay.
And then...
I was too scared to go at all, so I stayed home.
But yeah, I went with Rob and he did the interview, and then we hung out at the studio at 606 afterwards a little bit, which was really fun to, you know, sit and talk to Dave Grohl, who's an incredible musician and a super lovely person, you know. Yeah, just talk to him a little bit about music and how he got started and all that stuff. And then afterwards, they he put together the you know, all the recording sessions with everybody that done the interviews. And then the guys did the one song with Dave for that. And then I can't even imagine how he managed putting all this stuff together with so many different people. It must have been a logistical nightmare.
Yeah.
But he on the show in LA, which was just so well done. Like, I remember he didn't even seem really stressed or anything. Like, I would be so stressed if I had to put up a show like that with so many different artists. And, you know, not everybody is super easygoing. And, you know, people aren't as, like, laid back about stuff. But, it turned out great. It was an awesome evening. And
I just remember trying to stay out of the way. You know, I was like, whatever you want to do. Like, you know, had it started out with just a jam, and then I was like, well, let me put on another five or six guitar parts, and then I just left the bill and said, do what you feel like with it, you know, putting it together. And Rob came up with, you know, singing and stuff, and I to make life easier for everybody, I can't use step back and let them do their thing, you know.
Yeah, well, it came out fantastic. It's one of my favorite songs on that soundtrack, not just because I love BRMC, but just because it's a great song. But
it's fun to do.
So Lee, you've been in the band now for 10 years. The band's been around for 20.
Mm-hmm.
You've been around for 10. Do you still feel like the newbie sometimes? Or that I'll pass now?
Not so much. I mean, yeah, it's kind of crazy that it's been 10 years because it doesn't feel like it's been that amount of time. It's pretty trippy. You know, touring, we tour a lot. So that kind of turns into Groundhog Day. You lose track of time. And like the outside world is moving, and you know, you come home and all of a sudden people are married and have kids, and you're like in this weird bubble. So that's the only thing. It's kind of wild that it's already been 10 years. Like that trips me out when I think about that. But no, I don't particularly feel like the newbie anymore. I guess it's different from, I guess, the outside world. Like, some people will still in interviews or whatever, like, be surprised that, oh, really? It's been 10 years? Like, I still thought you were the new person. Yeah. Like, nah, I don't think you can really call me anymore.
No way.
Time has passed at this stage.
When I compare the first few albums with Nick and the albums with you on it, there's... I can definitely feel the band progressing in a way that I've loved for the past 10 years. It's just, there is a fantastic feeling to the band and to the music you guys make. But a few years ago, you actually had a pretty rough, little rough time of things. And you got
a bit of a
bump. Let's see. I mean, you know, unfortunately, you know, Robert's father passed. you were involved in a motorcycle accident, and then you had to have brain surgery.
Yeah.
Now, how long of a time period were all those happening?
Yeah, Robert's dad passed away in 2010. The motorcycle accident was like towards the end of 2011. And then the brain surgery was November 2014.
Okay.
So it was a little bit scattered, but it was still close enough together, you know, because they're pretty major things. Some of them, like, takes a little bit to get over. It was still close enough to where it felt like, oh my God, is this
one thing after another?
Yeah, it still felt a little bit like that. But yeah, I pulled the trigger on getting the surgery done like pretty quickly after I found out what had actually been going on, because I'd had so many issues.
What kind of issues were you having?
Just like being behind the kit didn't feel during the whole Spectre at the Feast for, which was like a year and a half on the road. Like nothing felt fluid or natural anymore. It was like I was fighting my body the entire time whenever we were playing, especially on stage with all the lights and stuff. Like I could definitely feel the, like my, what's it called? My, fine motor skills and all that stuff was, something just wasn't right. And my balance and everything just felt odd. And there, like, I knew that I was making like mistakes that maybe weren't super noticeable to the, like to someone watching, but it was very obvious to me that because it wasn't normal, just like weird little mistakes or just feel things where it just didn't feel right for a long time, for a year and a half. Like that's a long time to not have a good show where you feel comfortable on stage.
Was it something that Rob and Pete could notice? Were they saying anything to you like, hey, is something wrong? Or was it just something that you just noticed?
I think it was more internal that I could notice it because it just didn't feel right.
Okay.
But you guys could probably tell afterward, like after the fact, because I was so OCD in sound checks and setup. Like I was moving my kit up and down and side to side and driving everybody crazy with that because like I was just trying to figure out if there was a way I could get things to feel normal again. Yeah. And that wasn't happening. So yeah, I was driving people nuts during sound check with that.
And you were diagnosed with, is it Chiari?
Yeah, Chiari malformations.
Malformations. Okay. So what exactly is that?
I mean, the easiest way to explain it is that, like, if you imagine that your brain doesn't quite fit in your skull and then the cerebellar tonsils start herniating out the base of your skull, which then blocks the spinal fluid flow. And it was completely blocked in the back end.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So when they told you that, that's why you're saying you pulled the trigger pretty quickly.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, I spent time searching, making sure I had the right surgical team and everything in place. But I didn't want to sit around and wait for the neurological symptoms to get worse.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, there's only so far you can push that kind of stuff before it becomes irreversible damage. And as it turned out, like it was a little bit worse than what we initially thought based on all the various MRIs I had done, which was a lot. Like there was like weird, I think there was some scar tissue and stuff that was starting to build up back there. So, it turned out to be, it was a good choice. And I had like, if I hadn't had any symptoms, it would have been a different story. You know, if there's some people have Chiari, but they don't ever really get any symptoms. Okay. And then of course there's no need to have surgery for something if you aren't having any symptoms that are messing with your day to day life. I definitely had quite a lot of symptoms.
And you guys decided to let your fans know and make an announcement that you needed brain surgery. Was that a tough decision, or was that, hey, you know, we're going to be down for a while, we should let people know? Or
It was something we talked about because, like, normally I'm pretty private, and you know, I'm not out on social media sharing every minute of my day to day life. You know, like. Some people do that. I like to have my private life, but we made the choice to do that because we were having to cancel a show because of it. And yeah, we knew we were going to be, you know, not working for, you know, at least 6 months probably, or at least I wasn't going to be able to. So we figured probably best to just, be open and honest about it and let people know instead of like rumors starting to show up, and you know, that can turn into a whole other kind of messy. So,
oh yeah.
So yeah, it was actually Rob was really helpful in that and kind of encouraging me to let people know what was going on and feel comfortable with doing that. And I'm glad that I did that looking back at it, just because there were so many people that had gone through it that all of a sudden, like, our Facebook for a while became this sort of like Chiari Malformations forum where people sharing their stories, or like whether they'd gone through it themselves or knew someone that had gone through the same thing, or, you know, all different kinds of stuff. So it kind of became a support.
Yeah, you got, from what I understand, you had a really good outpouring from the fans. There's a GoFundMe, I believe, and in fact, I remember sharing the information with some friends, and that's how a couple of friends actually became fans of the band. They had seen they had seen that I had posted something on social media. I'm a little more active than you. I'll be honest with you. I'm a little more active on social media than you guys.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Well, I had posted something about it, and a friend of mine, she's a very empathetic person. She loves to, and she loves to learn about this stuff. So she said, what is going on? Is this a friend of yours? I said, no. It's just one of my favorite bands, and you know, and she could use some help and support. And she said, oh, she ended up donating as well, and ended up listening to the music and becoming a huge fan. So,
wow. Well, thank you. I appreciate the support. That was a very humbling experience to see how generous and kind people were during that period. It was. I had no plans of setting up anything like that. It was done by one of our friends, Ian Ottaway, who sometimes writes on our website.
Yes.
Known him for ages. And he just, he went ahead and put that up. He didn't talk to any of us about it. He just went with it. And it was very nice of him to set that up, and the support from fans and also like other people from other bands and stuff. It was really, really kind how many people were just so generous during that period. So that's definitely not something I'll never forget. That was really, really cool.
Well, let's talk about recovery.
Yeah,
let's move on. It's an amazing story.